Hello, I'm Steve Rakusik with South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
And I'm Del Droege, professor of biology at Dakota State University.
And today we're dissecting the frog.
Yep, use frogs as an example pretty much of the vertebrate body plan, because frogs are amphibians, which are one of the larger classes of vertebrates, and the vertebrate plan is fairly conserved. You know, you see digestive system, respiratory system, circulatory system looks largely the same. So frogs provide a way of looking at, you know, looking at a simpler animal in some ways and a more easily to obtain animal and still get a good idea what the vertebrate body plan is like.
We have two different ones here. Can you explain the difference between those two?
Yeah. Well, actually, I should first say that frogs are, as we did say, amphibians, and so they have a smooth, scaleless skin. And the skin is actually moist because they use it as a respiratory surface. So frogs, unlike most other tetrapods, four-limbed animals, actually use their skin for one of the major sources of oxygen, as well as, we'll see later on, lungs. And frogs are atypical in amphibians in that they lack a tail. They're in a group called anurans, which the name itself means without a tail. And they're, as everybody knows about frogs, they're highly modified for jumping. So they have these extended back legs, which allow them to leap long distances, or at least to hop like toads do. So they're a little atypical for amphibians, but they are the largest group of amphibians. There are more frogs and toads than any other kind of amphibian. And so again, fairly easy to obtain.
As far as jumping, there's some interesting about jumping. There's different stages.
Yeah, well, it's kind of hard to, if you kind of visualize this as the frog jumps, first the muscles, the thigh expand, then the shank, and then finally the foot actually pushes off. So
gives
it's like
that
a three
boost.
Way, it's like a three forces pushing the frog forward. So they're able to leap, you know, many, many body lengths, you know, that, you know, can leap 6-8 feet sometimes, some of these larger frogs. So
most of those right behind the eyes, there's a little something.
Oh, right. A little different externally. As you can see, there's a tympanic membrane right behind the eye. And we have a tympanic membrane too, our eardrum, as the name, you know, tympanic implies. And so this vibrates in response to sound waves. And so these animals are not only very good at picking up sounds, they produce sounds, as we know, for mating calls, territorial advertisement. And so oftentimes, the males is often larger than the females, the tympanic membrane, when you see that. Externally, say there's the opening to the urogenital and digestive systems, the cloaca.
Common
opening. Other than that, externally, they're pretty simple animals.
I was asking about the tongue, too. You were mentioning
the
tongue.
I don't know. We can try to open that up a little bit.
Here.
We can get the mouth structure.
Maybe not this one.
Maybe not
this one. This one's a little easier to open.
Yeah, let's try that one again. Yeah, there he goes.
All righty, I'll open this one up for you.
Yeah, and so you can look inside. And first of all, what you really notice is this large, fleshy tongue, which again is an adaptation for terrestrial animals. It's hard to catch food in terrestrial animals. You know, you can't, you know, just have the water currents carry it into your mouth. So you need to grab it and swallow it. And so many of the tetrapods now have a tongue. And what's unusual about a frog tongue is you can see it's hinged here in front. It's the back that's loose. And so they basically project that tongue out of the mouth in a living one. These preserved animals have shrunk up some, but that tongue would be able to push out with hydrostatic pressure and have a sticky end and catch an insect or whatever and pull it back in. So we often see that, you know, characterized in frogs, and it's true.
Absolutely.
And then, kind of push some other stuff out of the way. You can see down here's the opening to the esophagus, so the opening to the digestive tract. And I don't know if we can get him down.
Yep.
We may have to
open him up.
Cut him. I say, well, as you're looking at these kinds of things, you may have to clip the jaws there a little bit, and that'll allow you to.
I keep saying him. Any real good way to tell?
Well, it's hard to tell externally. There's a possibility with the with many frogs, and actually, here's an interesting thing with amphibians: they have 4 toes on their front foot and 5 toes on their back, whereas all the other tetrapods, reptiles, birds, mammals, have 5 on the front and 5 in the back. But the males have a slightly swollen base of the thumb there. You can see this structure right here. And probably for attaching during to the female or holding onto the female during mating.
We assume maybe a male here then?
So I would assume this one's a male. We'll get a shot to tell you then, once externally or internally, then of course you can tell.
But you wanted to show something?
I'll
dab it out of there a little bit.
Yeah.
Try it up a little bit for you.
Yeah, so can you hold him like that? So yeah, now he opens up quite a bit more. And you can see, first of all, if you want to move your finger just a little bit, yep. There are two ridges of teeth here. There's a ridge of small teeth. You can kind of feel them. They're sharp, little serrated structures. There's an outer layer and an inner layer, the maxillary and the vomerin teeth here, or palatine teeth, sorry. Two rows of those kind of hold food. They're not really for tearing or chewing or anything.
Mostly carnivore? Are these
yeah,
type,
yeah. Mostly eat insects, mm-hmm. Other small aquatic animals, okay. You know. And then there's the nares here. These are the internal nares, so they open from the nose. So they have paired nostrils, and so then those open into the mouth area. And then a little harder to see back here, there it is, eustachian tubes, which are internal openings to the ear.
Those are paired then?
Yep, too, there's paired. There's one over here. So those then go up. Those equalize the pressure between the inside the tympanic membrane and set to the inner ear. And then probably the other nice structure to look at here, if we can find it, is right here, is the glottis. You can see that. And that's the opening to the trachea that goes mm-hmm. to the lungs. And we have this too. We call it the epiglottis sometimes. Mm-hmm. But so when you're swallowing food, that closes, and so food doesn't go into your respiratory tract.
Nice
and
adaptation.
Clog your lung. Yeah, yeah. So that works out.
Very nice. Anything else on the outside here? Or?
No, not too much. I said
we did need to discuss the difference
between our two kinds of frogs. And these are two kinds of frogs that are commonly available from biological supply houses. This is probably the workhorse of biology, the one that most people use. They're a little bit smaller. They're the northern leopard frog, sometimes called grass frogs. Rhaena pipiens is their scientific name. And you can see they call them leopard frogs because they've got these dots mm-hmm. on them and the different kinds of a situation. So these are your common, you know, they're much more green when you see them in, mm-hmm. in living without being preserved. But this is, and the ones, so they're a little smaller, and then you can usually get, for most supply houses, you can also get bullfrogs, which are larger frogs. So they're a little bit larger, might mm-hmm. be easier to see things, but they're more expensive. So you mm-hmm. have to kind of balance, you know, which one you want to use.
Maybe one for display, maybe? Or,
yeah.
You know, if it depends on your budget.
And it might be a good time to say, just for a minute, that you know, say mm-hmm. these are vertebrate animals. Amphibians also, their populations are of some concern worldwide in terms of conservation. So it's a good idea mm-hmm. to, you know, we really gain a lot by studying living animals. There's a mm-hmm. lot of variability, and we can see the pattern. But we don't want to use these animals carelessly. Mm-hmm. You know, try to, you know, have students get into larger mm-hmm. groups or something, you know, use as few of them as we possibly
Absolutely.
Can. And don't just use them for, you know, 15 minutes, you know,
yep.
and things are.
Study them,
if you're going to study them. Otherwise, you know, videotapes like this hopefully
exactly.
provide the information that you need. Anyway.
We should also point out here, too, like maybe this one has some dye in there.
Oh, yeah. And then, yeah, you can also, another choice you have when you get your frogs are whether they're plain, uninjected mm-hmm. frogs, which just with preservatives, or they will also inject the circulatory system, and they'll inject it with a latex that will color the arteries and veins, and they'll use a red color for the arteries and a blue color for the veins. So if you're mm-hmm. gonna do if you really wanna look at the circulatory mm-hmm. system in some detail and how that works, then these injected frogs, which of course cost more.
Yep.
So we'll probably
dissect out a regular one and then
yeah.
we'll show an
yeah,
example.
Yeah, we'll do some plain and show yep. some examples if you would want to do them.